Welcome to the podcast Stories from Palestine. My name is Crystal, and I invite you to join me every week for interesting, inspiring, and unexpected stories from Palestine. 7 years ago, I moved from the Netherlands to Palestine to be with my Palestinian husband. We live with our two children in Beit Safafa, a town between Jerusalem and Bethlehem. We run a cafe and a bar in Bethlehem, and before the pandemic, I used to take tourists on alternative tours to learn about the reality of life for Palestinians in the West Bank. As the world is in lockdown due to the pandemic and we cannot receive any tourists at the moment, I decided to share stories from Palestine as a virtual tour. And maybe one day when the world opens up again, you will be inspired to come and discover the beauty of Palestine yourself. I created the website storiesfrompalestine.info and the Facebook page Stories from Palestine, where you can find links, photos, and background information. You can subscribe to my podcast so you will never miss an episode. Subscribe on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, or go to buzzsprout.com with double Z and search for Stories from Palestine to find the other podcast platforms that this podcast is listed on. And now, get ready for a new episode of Stories from Palestine. Let me start today's podcast by admitting something. I have an obsession, or better, I developed an obsession. I would have never had this obsession if I still lived in the Netherlands, because what I am obsessed with does not exist in the Netherlands at all. You could say that the Netherlands is the complete opposite of what I became obsessed with. It is so different, so utterly, totally very different. You see, the Netherlands is a very flat country, full of mud and grass that grows because of all the rain that created hundreds of lakes and rivers and ditches and canals. Half of the country is below sea level and it's all mud and sand and soil. And I am not really obsessed with mud. The mud is, by the way, the reason why people in the Netherlands used to wear, and some still wear, clogs, the wooden shoes, so that their feet wouldn't sink into the mud, the swampy mud. No, I am not obsessed with mud. I am obsessed with... Well, you really want to know by now, right? Okay, I'm gonna tell you. No, wait. Let me first tell you something else. The first time I arrived to Palestine was in the year 2006. I was 20 years old by then, and it was my first time ever on an airplane. I arrived to Ben Gurion Airport and hopped on a bus to meet an Israeli friend in Tel Aviv. I knew her from an event that I had joined, an event for youth that were interested in living an environmentally friendly lifestyle. And she was part of a group called the Israeli Anarchists Against the Wall. So the next 2 weeks we drove around the country, and believe it or not, but I had the weirdest notion that I knew this place. I connected to this place so instantly that I felt I had been here in a previous life. Or maybe unconsciously I knew that I was gonna end up staying here. And I wasn't sure what this feeling meant, because I'm not really religious. So it was not that being in the Holy Land and these things that turned some people on. It was something really more related to the land. Not the country, not the state, not the people, but really the land, the soil, the coastal plain, the mountain ridge, the Jordan Rift Valley, the Dead Sea, the lowest point on earth. And since that first trip, I have been coming and going here, and I've lived here permanently now for the last 7 years. And what really intrigues me, what really became my obsession with the land of Palestine, is the history of caves. Yeah, caves. I'll give you some time to let that sink in. If you look at a map, you will see that Palestine is on the Mediterranean Sea. The land close to the sea is lowland, the coastal plain. Driving from the sea towards the east, you will notice that slowly the road starts climbing up a bit and there's an area of rolling hills. And in the Bible, this area is already mentioned as the Shephelah. And then when you reach higher, the higher hills, the mountains, it is incredible, especially for someone like me from the Netherlands. These are really high hills. The mountain ridge has mountains as high as 1200 meters, but most of them are between 700 and 900 meters. And all these mountains are connected, so they form a ridge, a mountain ridge, from the north to the south in one line. This is the result of tectonic plate movement. So the Asian plate and the African plate, they are moving and they pushed up the whole area. This is why on the other side of the mountain ridge, the land goes down steep towards the Dead Sea from 900 meters above sea level to about 300 meters below sea level. This is the Jordan Rift Valley. This is all result of tectonic plate movement. That's going on under our feet. It has created the mountains and the deep valleys. And the mountains of this mountain ridge are of a rock or a stone that is called limestone. And limestone is a stone that was formed on the sea floor of marine fossils. It's very rich in calcium carbonate. So millions of years ago, when there was no land where Palestine is now, there was only the sea. And with the movement of the continents and the tectonic plate movement, it pushed up the limestone that was created on the sea bottom, formed on the sea floor, and the rocks of the mountain ridge came high above sea level. And this limestone is the perfect stone for forming caves. Because rainwater picks up carbon dioxide from the air, and this will turn the soil into a weak acid that then slowly dissolves away the limestone. And the cavities can grow over time into really large caves. And these caves, they are so interesting. You have to imagine this. In prehistoric times, which means in the time that people did not know how to write yet, what did people's life look like? They wouldn't be concerned with much else than just finding water and food, our basic needs. And then, if you've ever heard of the Maslow pyramid, our basic needs are food and shelter, so we can sleep and be safe. Now imagine, you are a prehistoric person in this land here, and you're looking for a safe place to sleep, a shelter from the wind and the rain or the hot sun from wild animals. Then what else is more exciting than finding a natural cave where you can just bring your whole family and move in without having to build anything? That is incredible, isn't it? Do you get my excitement? So in the year 1928, a British female archaeologist called Dorothy Garrett came to Palestine to do excavations, and she found a cave called the Shukba Cave, and you can look that up, Shukba, S-H-U-Q-B-A. I'll put a link on my website. And what she found there was a new yet undiscovered unique Stone Age period culture. What she found at the Shukba Cave was a lifestyle of a people that had not yet really developed agriculture, but they were definitely experimenting with growing their own food and domesticating animals. So they were not like the hunters and gatherers that were moving around as nomads to search for food, but they lived in and around this Shukba Cave. In this big cave, it's about 18 meters high, and that is really high for a cave, there were two chimneys, which means that they used to make fire inside the cave. And there were hundreds of pigeonholes dug into the cave's wall. So that means they had pigeons for their eggs and their meat. So they actually domesticated these pigeons. They also used tools that had never been found before from earlier hunters and gatherers. For example, they made stone sickles for harvesting grain, and then they used stone mortars and pestles to grind the wheat, which means they were growing wheat somewhere close to where they were staying. So they lived in, but they also lived around the caves. They found remains of small round-shaped huts close to the entrance of the cave. As the Shukba cave is located in a valley that is called Wadi Natuf, Dorothy Garrett, the archaeologist, coined the term Natufians for these people. And in later excavations in other sites, they have found similar lifestyle and habits around the same period in the Middle Stone Age, that is the period more than 10,000 years ago, and they called them the Natufians. And these Natufians also had interesting habits when it came to the burial of their dead. First of all, the hunters and gatherers, who were always on the move, would probably have buried their dead wherever they were at that moment. But the Natufians started actual burial sites, like a cemetery, with a wall around it to separate the burial place from the living area. And they found that the Natufians buried their dead with personal ornaments. So they used to make necklaces and bracelets and earrings. And I imagine you're maybe wondering, like, what material were they using for that, right? Well, they would use marine shells or animal bones or even animal teeth. And these decorations, they were found mainly on the skulls of the persons. It was also common for the Natufians to remove the skull, and the body would be placed in a strange curled up position. And all of this means that the Natufians had rituals, that they had their own habits and their own traditions. The Natufians are also the first we know about who used the caves. But after them, there are so many stories in Palestine that are related to caves. Close to Bethlehem, for example, there is a cave called the Kala cave in Wadi al-Khreitoun. This is very close to the Herodian, Herod's summer palace. It's on the edge of the desert. And in this cave, they discovered big blocks of stone that were set up in a circle, dating back from around 500,000 before Christ. And this suggests that they were probably sitting in a circle around a fire. So that would be the first traces of use of fire in Palestine, 500,000 BC. And if they sat around that fire, they may have had a language to speak and communicate with each other. We don't know, but I'm so intrigued by the idea that the same cave that we can visit today if we do a hike in the Khreitoun Valley, that already 500,000 years ago, people were staying in this cave. Wadi Khreitoun, by the way, is the name of a hermit, a monk, who lived on his own in this valley. And guess where did he stay in? Of course, in a cave. His name was Khariton, or Chariton. And he was a quite famous monk, and he had followers, people who kept following him from cave to cave. He wanted so badly to live a life alone as a hermit in the desert, but he couldn't shake them off, these disciples. So eventually he decided to get up into a hanging cave. Probably he used a kind of ladder that he could then pull up so he could be completely on his own in his hanging cave without people entering into it. I will do another podcast on monasticism in Palestine because that is a very important part of the history of the Jerusalem wilderness. Now at this point I would like to check in with one of my colleague students at the Bethlehem Bible College to ask him which are his favorite cave-related stories. He's my colleague Ibrahim Kher. He's also a professional translator and a German teacher, and he's also studying to become a local tour guide. So, hi Ibrahim, how are you doing?
Hey Crystal, thanks for having me on your podcast today. Also, thank you for asking about me. I'm doing fine, doing great.
Ibrahim, let me go straight to my question to you. We studied a lot about caves in Palestine. So what are your favorite cave stories?
Caves, to be honest, are a very vast and complicated subject in historic Palestine. And I believe they played a very important role in turning key points in the history of Palestine. I'm going to talk about the caves of Qumran. Well, To know about a little bit about the history of the place, Qumran is a place near the shores of the Dead Sea. So you can imagine, it's a very hot desert. It's a place of seclusion. just like those chosen by the monks where they used to dwell in caves. This area was chosen by a people called the Essenes. They were Jews who resided there between the 3rd century BC and the 1st century AD. So these people wanted to be in seclusion. They wanted to focus or dedicate their lives to writing the history of the place and writing the Bible and its documents, to be specific. How we knew about this place? The story dates back to 1947, just 1 year before the Nakba. So we can imagine this shepherd, known by the name Muhammad al-Deeb, he was taking his sheep and his flock to eat some grains and some wild plants. So he wanted to find a shelter for himself. While walking there, he found a cave. And just like any other shepherd, he would cast a stone inside the cave just to check if there are any wild animals, any hyenas, any dogs, anything that resides in this cave, in order for them to go out, and he would go inside and find shelter to prevent the heat of the sun. So what he heard was the breaking of jars. When he stepped inside, he found loads of jars with documents inside. Some were intact, some were rusty because of the date. He didn't know at the time, but it was some of these jars were almost 2,000 years old, and maybe older than that, between 2,300 years of old. So he took some of them, and he thought he would take them to sellers of antiquities. So long story short, he took them to a couple of sellers who managed to buy a couple of them, and then they reached the hand of an archbishop in Jerusalem who knew what they were and who feared the war of 1948, the Nakba, would affect them or would result in them being forgotten, being stolen. So he chose to smuggle them to New Jersey in America. Later on, they were sold in a journal, and one of the Israelis laid hands on them and bought them as an asset for the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. And between 1953 and 1956, a shrine was built over them for the people to come and see them and for everybody to observe them. So the excavation started in the area of Qumran, where 11 caves were excavated at the time, and almost 15,000 fragments and relics were found, and almost 800 documents of the Hebrew Bible, Hebrew script, were found. Everything that we know about the Bible except for the book of Esther. And also, we found the rule of the community written by Prophet Isaiah. This stone that the shepherd casted echoed throughout the world. It didn't echo just in Qumran or just in Palestine, but it echoed from a cave inside historic Palestine to the whole world. I recently read in a journal, in an article, that until today, there are people still living in caves in Palestine. A community of 1,500 people are still living in caves in Yatta, but unfortunately, because of the occupation forces, certain rules are set for them that they should not build in front of the caves, they should not build modern houses on top of the caves, so that's why they still dwell in the caves, but they managed somehow to turn those caves into cells of dwelling, living places, places for storage, and places for the animals. So they are somehow modern. They try to use modern technology. They use generators. They have places two wells where they take water out of them, and they use generators. They are modernized, but still they try to implement this modernized lifestyle into not known 1,000 years of old caves. And I personally have a story that I experienced myself. It was back in 2008 when we as youngsters started with the Tent of Nations youth group. This Tent of Nations youth group started as an initiative by the family of Nassar, Daoud Nassar, who owned a piece of land inside the block of Gosh Atzion, which means it's surrounded by four settlements. And the state of Israel wanted this land from the Nassar family. Fortunately, they could prove documents dating back to the Ottoman times that the piece of land belongs to them. It's around 400 dunams, which is very massive. So Israel offered them whatever you can imagine. They offered them nationalities in whatever country they choose. They offered them the amount of money that they can choose, but they were very, very loyal to their country, so they refused every offer and stayed in the land until today. But what the state of Israel, the occupation country, did to force them to actually leave the place was that they prevented them from building 1 meter higher above the ground. So what they thought, or actually what foreigners thought at the time, because what they did, the Nassar family, is bring in foreigners every year to reside in the piece of land and to cultivate the area in order to show the Israelis that we are here and we live in our piece of land, so you can't just take it away from us and you can't have settlers come to the land. So one of the foreigners at the time, he suggested that we build inside the caves and we raise just 1 meter above the cave. So when the Israelis would come, or when the court would come and with the military, they would see that we built only 1 meter above the ground, and that would be not against the law that they invented and actually implemented. So we either went into caves and built on top of them, 1 meter on top of them, or we dug under the ground 2 meters and built 1 meter above the ground, which means 3 meters in total. I now can relate, and I couldn't remember that story much, but now since we're in the subject, I just remembered, you know, how everybody, including us, we tended to take the cave and turn it or make it into our need in such difficult circumstances, just as our ancestors 120,000 years ago thought. They came here, they saw Mount Carmel, they thought, okay, this is a place where I can start off. This is a place where I can reside. This is a place where it can protect me. So this is how we thought. We still think the same. 120,000 years later, we still think the same. One last story that I want to talk about is the caves of the Machpelah. It's the land purchased in Hebron by Abraham from Ephron the Hittite. He purchased the land to bury his wife Sarah when she died, and he chose the land, or he bought the land in order to put hands on a piece of land inside historic Palestine and to be for his generation offspring or generations to come. He wanted this piece of land to be his own, to be purchased, even though the Ephron the Hittite, which was Canaanite by the way, he offered it to him. That's where we see that actually the Canaanites and Israelites didn't have or didn't fight, just like the propaganda say, they didn't fight much, but actually they believe in the same thing. They respect each other. So Ephron the Hittite offered him the land for free, but Abraham refused because he wanted something to be actually his in this land, where he can securely bury his wife Sarah. So those are a couple of stories that I wanted to share with you today. And again, thank you for having me on your podcast.
Thank you, Ibrahim. Thank you very much for these stories that you added. And I will see you back in college next week. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you again for having me today.
By now, you may start to understand a little bit more about my obsession with caves. Did you know that many of the biblical stories also evolve around caves? I may completely shock some of you now with this information, but in Bethlehem, nobody believes that Jesus was born in a wooden stable and laid in a wooden manger. They all know that Jesus was born in a cave. Yeah, let that sink in for a second. According to the locals in Bethlehem, what happened was that Mary and Joseph didn't find a place to stay in Bethlehem when they came to register for the Roman census. And Joseph must have had family in Bethlehem to stay with, but because it was so busy, his family members had no place in their guest rooms up in the house. And that's how Mary and Joseph ended up in the lower part of the house, which was the place where the animals usually stayed in the winter time, and which was often built right in front of a cave, so that the space inside the cave could be used as well. And that explains why Jesus was born surrounded by the animals. Today, if you visit the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem, you will see that the church was built over this cave. And once you are inside the church and you proceed towards the end of the nave, there are stairs down under the apse or the choir that lead to the birth cave of Jesus. Another church in close proximity to the famous Church of Nativity is the Milk Grotto Church. This church was built over the grotto or the cave, where, according to the local Palestinian Christians, Mary is said to have nursed baby Jesus. And when a drop of her milk fell on the cave's floor, the color of the stone in the cave turned miraculously to a white milk color. Many Palestinian women, both Muslims and Christians, venerate Mother Mary, either as the mother of the Son of God or as an important prophet for the Muslims, and they come to this milk grotto cave to take some of its stone, crush it into a powder, and then drink it with water or milk in order to get pregnant. And I know it sounds like an unlikely thing to happen from cave stone, and I wouldn't believe it myself if I had not personally experienced this miracle. When I got married to my Palestinian husband 7 years ago, my parents came over for that big wedding party. Yeah, there was around 700 people in the wedding. And I took my family to visit Bethlehem, and we went to the milk grotto. And as I was explaining to them the same story I just told you, I swiped my finger over the rock and I licked my finger for like a more lively example of this miracle story. And guess what? 6 weeks after this, I was pregnant. Now, related to the birth story of Jesus, there is another cave that is very relevant to mention. That's the cave where the shepherds were attending to their sheep when the angel appeared to announce the birth of Jesus. This happened only 2 kilometers down the hill from Bethlehem, and it's in a place that is known as Beit Sahur. This is the town where my husband and I run a cafe and a bar. The name of the town means the house, Beit, of vigilance, Sahur. It means to keep careful watch, and this is what the shepherds did while watching their flock by night. Now, it's quite funny that today there are two locations that are called shepherd's fields, one with a Catholic and the other one with an Orthodox church. But both sites have a venerated cave. For Muslims, there is also a very important cave in Jerusalem. In the Quran, there is mention of the night journey of Muhammad, the Isra and Miraj. And in this story, Muhammad is transported by night on a white winged horse named Al-Buraq from the Great Mosque in Mecca to the furthest mosque, which is in Arabic Al-Aqsa. And after praying in a cave beneath the nearby foundation stone, the Prophet then continued on to heaven before returning to Mecca in the same night. Now, even though in the Quran the site of the furthest mosque is never mentioned, it became the tradition that Prophet Muhammad reached Jerusalem, and the Dome of the Rock and the Aqsa Mosque were built on the cave and the foundation stone. You see, caves are fascinating, and they have amazing stories to tell. The longer I live in Palestine and the more I learn at this tour guide program of the Bethlehem Bible College, the more I feel connected to this place. As if I am reconnecting to something. Maybe I once lived in one of these caves here. Who knows? If you want to come and explore some caves in Palestine, then put a visit to Palestine on your bucket list. We can make it happen. I can help you with logistics, finding accommodation that suits your wishes and your budget, and I can either be your tour guide or hook you up with a Palestinian tour guide such as Ibrahim Kher. You have been listening to Stories from Palestine, a podcast that focuses on history, cultural heritage, and stories from Palestine. You can subscribe to Stories from Palestine on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, or search Stories from Palestine on buzzsprout.com and find all the other podcast platforms that this podcast is listed on. You can stay connected with me and my guests on the website storiesfrompalestine.info and on Facebook and Instagram. That's where I post photos, links, and more background information. I really appreciate donations to support this podcast, especially during this pandemic that brought a complete halt to the tourism sector. You can find my PayPal account on the website, Facebook, or in the show notes on Buzzsprout. paypal.me/chrisjustice. I look forward to you joining again next week for another episode of Stories from Palestine.